For a company to serve a market and generate demand, they need to know, amongst other things, what product to produce, how to make it, who's going to buy it, how to distribute it, and how much to charge. It's already quite the list, but when you consider that multinationals are working across borders, where all these things need to be tightly coordinated and synchronized, crossing multiple different factories, warehouses, operational teams, and time zones, and then on top of that, you're under the pressure to meet the requirements of some pretty large clients, then suddenly from an inventory perspective, things can get really interesting. So for example, if production makes things that marketing don't sell, there is overstock. And vice versa, if marketing is pushing items that are not in stock, then this can create customer dissatisfaction. So how do companies deal with this balance? Well, enter our subject today, sales and operations planning, which you might have more commonly heard being referred to as S&OP. At its core, S&OP helps synchronize large organizations by leveraging deeper alignment between the supply chain and other key departments, such as sales, finance, and production. So, how does it work? Well, let's follow an example using our deodorant here. The process is normally led by a senior member of the team, often the CEO, who, much like the captain of a ship, is responsible for establishing the direction and the entire strategy behind it. S&OP helps put this into action by emphasizing a series of meetings which focus on the following key areas. First up is sales forecasting. This is the one which tends to capture both the good and bad attention, as the supply chain practitioners spend hours tuning their models to provide insights on historical sales data. Then there is demand planning, basically the assessment of these forecasts to see if there are any external influences which might change the results, such as someone making a hit social media campaign about how using this deodorant is going to get me dating a model. Then is supply planning. Once we've worked out what the demand is likely to be, we need to ensure we have enough capacity to service our clients. Then, finally, once all these stages have been completed, then the plans are reconciled, finalized, and hopefully everyone should be pulling in the same direction as the strategy of our captain. And this process is cyclical. So once it has been completed for the first time and we've sold a few tins of deodorant, then of course we need the ability to buy more raw materials and keep producing. So we circle back round again, adjusting each step as required. So despite starting off with forecasting, you can see that the sheer number of people involved in the S&OP process means that there's always going to be design by committee situation, with some department always having an incentive to distort the results of the process. A good example of this is the sales team, who might propose conservative targets, so they always exceed expectations. As such, to conclude, whilst S&OP may correctly identify many of the challenges which are at the core of our supply chains, such as the need to synchronize operational teams, the solutions that are preferred by this approach are fundamentally a little dated. S&OP focuses on improving the end results, which is never ending as input data is continually being refreshed. As such, we believe that best practice should focus on those ever-moving targets and improving the numerical recipes themselves. So that's everything for this week. Let us know what you think in the comments below, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.